Yo, here with the one, Taylor McFerrin. How are you?
I'm great, man. It's good to see you.
It's great to see you, man. Today's actually the actual release date of Blackmagic. And yeah, I woke up reminiscing about like the whole scene that kind of like you and I were in. We're like adjacent stars in this constellation, you know. I was going back, I listened to your EP this morning too, and I was just remembering like how proud I felt, honestly, to like know that, because I was in London, you know, signed to Brownswood, you know, and it was so, you know, it's such a small but like vibrant scene of like London producers on their ish, you know. And to have like you and like Flylo kind of like penetrate that in a way, like I was so like hyped to be like, oh yo, there's Americans in this too? Cause I didn't really know anything about that electronic scene. I was coming from jazz. Uh-huh. It was really dope to like find it and then find your music. And it was a moment because everybody was so hyped on your EP. I remember just like that circle, like around Giles, all those producers, presenters were just talking about you. But I don't think I had actually met you at this point.
No.
Yeah.
The whole way that happened for me was very eye-opening because it was super organic and I didn't even realize that was going to happen at all. It was really my roommate at the time, his producer Hayden, who's a really good friend of mine. I mean, he was my roommate and then we stayed really good friends. He was really putting me on to the broken beat scene. Mm. That was like super, you know, leading the charge on the production to, and it was like, it felt like I grew up in the Soul Quarians were kind of like my world that I was like, I gotta be a part of this. But it felt like that was happening in London and a lot of that energy was transferring over there. It was like soul music, but like a lot of polyrhythms and they were messing with all the production in really cool ways. And the whole reason Broken Vibes, the EP even happened, was my homie Dundee, who's a DJ, producer friend of mine in New York.
Yeah.
He was working for Comedy Central and MTV. He would get these random gigs. And he hit me up because the VMAs were happening, coming up, and they needed all these beats for like when they're coming back from commercial and they VMAs with music playing in the background.
Right.
They needed those like 10 to 30 second clips of tracks. And Broken Vibes happened because he was like, I need a rock track, a hip hop track,
and
an electronic track, or like a house beat. And I've been hearing so much broken beat that I was like, all right, let me just do like a broken beat one for the electronic thing. And so I just made this 30 second broken beat clip, and it was really for that, and it got used, but it just had such a vibe that I extended it to a full thing. And then I was working in this other band at the time, backing up the singer, and one of the backup singers in the band was this dude Vincent, and I was like, this guy's voice is just butter, let me see if he'll jump on this broken beat track.
Wow.
So that's how that song came together. It was super random.
Yeah.
I had a DJ friend in Philly who passed along the tape of these songs to Ty.
Yeah, man.
Rest in peace, man.
Yeah.
And he actually, I think, titled the song Broken Vibes.
Wow.
Just as like to give it a track, give it a name, and to be able to send it to someone else.
Crazy.
Crazy.
I don't know any of this. This is amazing.
Right. So everything just kind of was happening all on its own. And then my homie Tyler Askew had just started this mini label called Rude Movements, which was also a party that was happening at APT, which was like the scene in New York, like the center of the scene we're talking about. And he wanted to put out the stuff as like a limited vinyl release. And so everything just kind of happened on its own.
Wow.
And then for me to feel all this love from London, and us, like the scene just accepted me.
Yeah, immediately. Yeah, immediately.
And so it opened up everything for me. Like I went over there, people, like I had all these shows that were packed and people were hyped about it. I was like, I don't know. It showed me a lot about the power of music and how, you know, your tribe is just kind of out there.
Mm.
You just make stuff, you never know how it's going to just reach people. Cause I had no plan. I really got lucky with all the people that like did all these other steps for
right.
me right away.
Every emerging artist watching this is like, yes.
Yeah.
No plan.
Totally. And I remember, yeah, the Reset EP was out at the same time when I was in London on my first trip. Philo was playing at Benji B's party he was throwing.
Right.
And so, yeah. And so yeah. I went to that. That's when I found out he knew about me. We just kind of said, what's up?
Yeah.
You know, so all these connections just kind of like, it was definitely a scene.
It felt like
the scene just accepted me because I've never really been on the message boards, on the internet, digging, finding stuff. I've always just been fortunate to have, you know, friends that were super into stuff and they'd play me things and I just kind of interpret it and it would seep into my music. And yeah, so then we knew about each other more from the New York kind of club scene that we were both playing the same clubs, like New Blue. I probably saw you at New Blue for the first time.
Well, I feel like we did some Giant Step event that we were on the same lineup once too. Yeah. Somewhere in like,
oh, right.
Yes.
Right at that that venue that's like the Asian ballroom.
Yeah.
In Chelsea.
Hero Ballroom?
Yeah, Hero Ballroom.
There was another one though. There was another event I'm trying to remember. Early on, it was like in the LES. I was there and I feel like you were, maybe you were presenting with another band or as part of another band.
I was in a bunch of bands at the same time. I was in a trio with a singer and keyboard player that was called Raj. The singer was Raj. And I was playing keyboard drums. And then TK Wonder, I was in a thing with her where she was the rapper and I was producing her. So for a while, I was doing solo shows. Mm-hmm. But really, my solo shows were my stuff plus my other groups like featured in the show. So it was probably that.
Yeah. And I feel like we kind of like acknowledged each other, but we didn't like make, you know, because it was a Giant Step event for sure. Which is interesting too, because that's London through Warwick, you know. I feel like him and Giles are kind of like this, on the same wave.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, because you hit me with all the Minneapolis connections that I didn't even know.
Right. Yeah. That's great. Yeah.
Well, I guess we should say what those are since we just don't even know.
right.
But yeah, we went to the same high school for like 1 year. And you knew of me because I was younger and then you knew who my dad was.
Yeah.
But we never met, or maybe I don't know if you ever said what's up to me.
No.
I was actually only at that school south for one trimester.
Right.
Remember, I don't know why they did trimesters there, but.
Yeah, that's cool. It's true.
And then I bounced. So when you told me that we went to the same school, I was like, everything felt very small and strange, but I think that was at Hero Ballroom where you told me that.
Yeah, crazy. Yeah, and I remember, I think our like musical connection was like, we knew each other and then we both got booked on Worldwide in Singapore. And we were like the only Americans or something, or the only New Yorkers. Mm-hmm. I feel like we might've been the only Americans on that, looking back. It's like Mark Pritchard, Giles, obviously, Chosho, Mansoor, like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And like, you and I were just like on the same flight for like 14 hours. And like,
we got off on the layover. We had like a 3 hour layover. So we just grabbed lunch together.
Right. In Frankfurt.
Yes.
Right. Back when it was like really not great airport. There was like one restaurant and like,
mm-hmm.
it was like, you can have sausage or sausage. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I remember we kind of like, you know, like musician, and this is why I love musicians and musical people. Because it's like, what are you working on? I feel like it's always like forward looking. It's like, what are you doing right now? And I was like, oh man, I'm doing all these. I'm working with Flylo. You know, you can send me all these beats or whatever. Because at that point, Blackmagic was totally just like not a thing. Mm-hmm. I put out The Dreamer, which was very jazz, like very like my little New York, you know, hip hop adjacent, but like pretty hardcore jazz actually.
Mm-hmm.
And then Giles had me cover Freestyle Fellowship's Park Bench People on that. Mm-hmm. So people kind of put me in like a Gil Scott, like, okay, you're hip hop, Gil Scott, jazz, soul thing.
Right.
And it's interesting too, I wanted to mention this, you know, it's when you're young and you kind of put something out with no expectation, it's kind of weird because like people will just brand you and that just stays with you forever. You know what I mean? Like the jazz vocalists of the hip hop generation are like the next Bill Scott Heron. And I was kind of like, well, I remember being in interviews and being like, yeah, it's not really, that's not really what I'm going for. I'm like, you're the next Gil Scott Heron. It's fine. You don't understand how this works. Like, you've been slotted in for a thing.
Yeah, you know, I remember sitting reading that all the time about you.
Yeah.
But yeah, that airport, that essentially, you just wanted to hear what I was working on. And I think I just played you the beats I had that were super
finished. You had like 50 beats. Just, yeah. You're like, yo, I don't know, whatever.
Yeah.
Like, typical. Like Taylor McFerrin, like reluctant genius. You're like, I don't know. These are like all probably trash, but like it's a long flight, whatever, you know?
Yeah.
And yo, like every beat was just like better than the next one. You know what I mean? And I remember I got to that, what became Love Conversation, and it totally messed me up, man. It was, I'd never heard a track like that. It was like moody, like the beats were dope. And you're playing everything, but like what I love about your work is like, it's hard to tell what's played, what's programmed. Like it's mm-hmm. so seamless, mm-hmm. and I feel like it doesn't lose either. You know, so many people, it's like there's like beats with like stuff on it, and it feels like it doesn't quite gel. Mm-hmm. Or the other way, like bands trying to like play like a produced world. You know what I mean? Like. Have such a thorough understanding as a producer and sonically that you can just make it sound like this vibe, which I really only, I think the only other person I heard do that was like, you know, with D'Angelo, you know, kind of made it all feel like one thing and you didn't miss anything, you know? So I heard that track, which was just a loop.
It was totally just a loop.
Just a loop, yeah.
But what's funny is that it was very hypnotic. I remember when I made it, I used to like leave it on loop at my house.
Yeah.
So then I'd leave home and come back and it was just playing. Something about that song just felt right. But I remember when you had it, I kept being like, yo, let me add a couple more elements.
Right.
Before you work on it. But then like you got Jordana on it and y'all basically made it just sound like it really didn't need anything else once you added all the sections. And I was like, actually, yeah, this loop vibes is cool.
Wait, but I remember you were like, yo, you can't have that one.
Oh, right.
I remember you being like, yo, you can have, the other ones are free, but actually that one, there's some other artists. And I was like, yo, like what? And I don't know if you know this story, but like, I was like obsessed with that track, like on the whole flight. And we got to Singapore. We were staying in this like pimped out hotel where the event was to downstairs. Mm-hmm. Like that sounds so good right now, by the way. And I remember going to Giles's suite and everybody was kicking it there. It was like the unofficial business party room. And he was like, what's up? And I was like, yo, Taylor just played me. This track is so fire. And I put it on. I don't know if you had sent it to me or maybe you played it for him later. Can't remember. But I was
I think I did send it to you.
Yeah, and I was like, yo, this is, and he was like, oh, you know how Giles gets? He's like, we've got to have it. Like, how do we, I'm going to move heaven to earth to make it happen, you know? So I feel like he probably worked on you, you know, a little bit.
No, I don't remember any of that. I just remember you playing me a finished version of the song over it. And I was like, well, I can't front. This is amazing. Let's do it.
Well, I ended up, so it was weird. I'm kind of jumping around, but I ended up like getting 4 extra days somehow of like hotel on that trip. I don't know why. Everyone else left. Y'all peaced out. And I was just in Singapore, like in this hotel for 4 days, which was like super weird. Cause I wasn't really used to like international travel like that. So I was just like, all right, what do I do? Also Singapore is like crazy expensive. You know what I mean? You're like, I don't know. I can buy these Jordans that are like $500 for no reason, or I can like, go to, like, they have 50 different malls in Singapore. That's all you do is just spend.
It's a trippy place, man.
Yeah. And so I wrote that top line for, you know, what became Love Conversation while I was there. Because it was, like, rainy. It was, like, moody. it was kind of weird because like all the party had literally left, you know, mm-hmm. All these amazing people, and it was just like me, I like my feelings. Yeah. Out of the world. And yeah, I was really tight with Jordana, who I feel like she knew you, at least artistically, from the Bay. Uh-huh. Because she's such a Bay person, and she was like, oh, Taylor, like, you stuck, whatever. And she was definitely on some of those giant stuff parties, too. I sent her the instrumental to write to, and then we didn't share it with each other till we got to the studio. Mm-hmm. And then she sang her part, and I was like, yo, that's killing. And I sang my part, and they were totally different, like, approaches. Mm-hmm. But I could hear them, like, how they just fit in perfectly together. Mm-hmm. And I was like, yo, we're using both. And she was like, wait, what? So we just laid it down, and that's how it happened. It was crazy. Like, she heard, go slow, and I had to, I want to talk to you over it. And it was like totally sounded like, yes. Yeah.
No, listen, you know.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Wow. Yeah. So that's how it happened, man. It was super easy. But yeah, I mean, that track, maybe more than any other track I've worked with, it was just so much like emotional space too. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And I don't know how you like approach that. Back then, or if you remember, like making that track, like how did you construct that feeling? You
know? At the time, I had my drum set up in my apartment, which is so underrated. Like having that, like there's a few tracks that I recorded with those drums on there, and if you listen to it, you can hear that the drums are like just they really sound like they're just in a room.
Yeah,
but you know, I played a lot of the drum parts on Early Riser and that, and it was basically all recorded in the apartment. And then like, I can't really play guitar, but I basically play guitar, especially in that era. I was just playing one string, one note at a time, and then overdubbing it. So it sounded like playing, like strumming.
Yeah.
And then the song is really just guitar, Rhodes, and maybe one or two synth parts.
Mm.
I don't know. I didn't really overthink it. It was just, it's totally just my sound. It's just my instruments. I think the biggest reason my tracks usually sound like me is just, I use this, the same kind of instruments on all my stuff. And I like the same type of chords, and it's a simple song, but it definitely just had a vibe. And I think the reason I was telling you, I didn't want to give it to you at first is like, I really had Erykah Badu in mind.
Okay.
I hate it, so I was just like, I gotta figure out a way to try to get it to her.
Yeah.
But you know, y'all just made it so beautiful that I had no regrets at all. It was just came out amazing.
Man, you and Erykah would be dope.
She just followed me on Twitter like last week. Man. So
yeah, that needs to happen.
I hopefully it will, yeah. Mm. I always feel like things can't happen, and then but I literally know everybody that she's really good friends with, so.
Yeah, like literally everybody.
Yeah.
Interesting. Do you have like tons of ways like for people just like if you're like, oh, Erykah, so I got something for you?
I might. I don't know. I tend to always want to do stuff that I just made recently, which is can be a curse, because then I have stuff that just feels old to me, like, and I didn't want to play people, but I don't know. It feels like a good time to just the moment right now is like perfect for someone like her to sing one of my beats.
Yeah, just experiment, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if people know this about you, but like you, from what I've seen, like you create nonstop. Mm-hmm. And you've changed a bit, you know?
Yeah.
By the time you get to the end of that process of experimentation, you're like, okay, I'm such a better producer than when I started. Now I want to do completely a whole nother thing. And you know, I don't think there's anything like inherently wrong with that. I feel like visual artists are the same.
Yeah.
Like with, or, you know, you try, you work up to get to a thing.
Yeah.
But you know, in the case of like Picasso or anybody who's just that killing, those sketches are like as valuable to us now as like some of the masterworks, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I'm definitely curious to hear some of that stuff. I mean, I've been asking you for years. Mm-hmm. You got a lot just sitting there, you know. But I don't know how you feel about that. Is it like an invasive process? Is that like a private thing where you're like, that's just for me to get to this place?
No, it's, I don't see it as a good thing at all. I mean, most projects that when I release stuff, I just have so many things that are in, I consider them in the sketch phase.
Mm-hmm.
But then I usually don't, when I finish the song, I usually actually don't re-record stuff from scratch. I usually still take the original and just start adding more layers and mix it so it ends up sounding professional.
Mm-hmm.
So I've just always had a problem, like almost every day I open up a blank slate and start something new versus like finishing what I have.
Oh, interesting.
So the EP that I'm finishing right now, it's going to be like 5 tracks, but it's probably between 40 and 50 sketches that were just like, I went through, and then eventually I just scan over everything I did and I'm like, these 5 actually make sense together in this order. Let me put them in this order and add the final layers over all of them so that they connect. That tends to be my process, but I don't know. I mean, it's frustrating for me because I feel like I'm doing so much work, but I'm sharing such a small percentage of it, and that doesn't really vibe with how the world works right now. And also, you know, I'm not looking at it like that's the right way to do it, and I'm whatever. I more feel like I have an issue finishing ideas. So I think part of what we're all going through right now is everyone's figuring out how to transition into a new way of being an artist and how to present your work. And this is forcing me to evaluate, should I just share myself going through that process and saying, it's probably like, you finished that song for me, really. Like, I might've never finished it if I hadn't played you what I thought was unfinished. So I think I'm kind of entering into a phase where it's more important to share what I consider a work in progress, and you know, people gravitate towards it and, you know, be more collaborative.
That's fascinating, man. I mean, yeah, it's kind of interesting because I know that we also love people like Madlib, who are just like putting it out. And, you know, like, I love Madlib. I think some of his stuff is like better than others. You know what I mean? Obviously, some stuff you could tell he's like, he got smoked up. He's like, yeah, that's cool. Put it out. Ideas. And I think we, you know, obviously, like, jazz is a big part of our connection. It's a very jazz thing. You know, you just like, catch a vibe, you put it down. It was where you were at that minute. You know, I mean, I think, speaking as a fan of yours, I think it would be dope if you dropped this, like, off that Bandcamp, like a lot of producers are doing right now. Like, yo, this is 50 tracks, just like, you know, drafts or whatever. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, putting it out there. I think it would be.
I might do it. You know, I definitely have enough material to do that. I mean, I am finishing up an actual finished project now, so I think after that's out, I'm going to treat it more of a launch pad to feel free to do whatever. Because it was weird. It's like I dropped a record in August, and this summer was when I was supposed to reap the benefits of all the heavy touring and festivals, and it's just gone. So it's weird. It feels like the record didn't live its full lifespan.
Yeah.
And now it's like, I feel like also tonally and mentally, everybody's just had the shift where it almost feels weird to, no one's feeling how they felt last August.
You know? Yeah, it's in a party happy mood, like trying to celebrate some shit. It's different tone in America for sure. Yeah, I know what you mean, because I did the same. You know, No Beginning, No End 2 came out, and it was like, you know, everybody was feeling a certain way, and now here we are. And you know, that's kind of interesting too. Like, I don't know the answer to that question. You know, like, I guess I'm putting out 2 albums this year, which is weird, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But do I want to even tour them next year? You know what I mean? And I know for fans, like, there's probably fans who, you know, who heard your album were like, yo, that's gonna be the next tour. So they're like waiting there. So you can run it, and I've done this for years, you know, this like run the risk of like, all right, that's over now. I knew. Like, I remember I went to see Michelle Negocello. She, you know, she puts out albums like, she makes Drake look lazy, you know what I mean? And, you know, I was like really into, I think that album's called Weather, you know? And I was really into it. It had just come out like a month before the show at LPR. She dropped like one song from it. I was like, yeah, I'm on this other thing now, this other unreleased thing. Basically, rehearsal for her next album. You know what I mean?
Crazy.
And, you know, and I respected it, but I was like, yo, like, what? Like, I came for this. Like, this just came out. And she was like, yeah.
Well, what I wanted, it was like, I was, the first round of shows I was really doing straight up me kind of playing the instrumentals of the album and maybe one layer live while I sang, which was already like a big step for me to like sing a whole show. And then I was building up towards trying to tour with a real band because that's a whole different energy than kind of singing over the instrumentals. But, you know, now it's like, that's impossible. But, you know, I think once I drop this new EP, I'll feel really free to do a bunch of virtual shows and maybe, you know, there's a bunch of different ways to just like be out there, but it's all virtual. It just feels strange. I know for me, we were just talking earlier about your body and your mind is tuned to feeling like you're supposed to be jumping on a plane and going on a tour right about now.
Exactly.
But you're just not, and you're just not having that human interaction, which is important for me because I am such a hermit and an introvert that I'm one of those people that has kind of like two sides where it's like, I don't talk much. People don't really see me out a lot, but I need that interaction on stage just to have the other, that part of my psyche be fulfilled. Now it's just like trying to find where that energy is supposed to be placed and how it's, you know, supposed to be out there. But hopefully things will start getting a little bit more back to normal. But in the meantime, it's definitely interesting to see all the homies that are like finding ways to, you know, just keep it moving. You've been really dope about it. I've been seeing all the stuff you've been doing. It just feels like I'm seeing you and feeling your energy where I've been on the like trying to be in my lab, like come up with a master plan. When really, I think these days people want to see your process and want to feel like they're a part of it, which I've always been a little bit hesitant to do, but you know, I think it's probably time for me to get on that.
I know what you mean. I feel like there's a natural reluctance on the part of every artist. And I would even say with Black artists in general, it's like, you don't want somebody stealing your process.
Right.
Now people are like marketing, like have whole jobs of just process, you know?
Yeah.
No end, you know, you're just like, I'm going to teach you how to do this thing that I can't even do myself, you know?
So right.
So I think there is a reluctance to sort of like give away too much.
Yeah.
But, you know, like for anybody watching, man, we actually did a tour in Japan, which was dope. Like we've done a few international tours together that were crazy. And you, we did like what, six shows in Japan, you know, between Osaka. And yo, every night you just walked on stage and for like 20, 25 minutes, just created.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I had recorded those nights, yo, because like, all of us were like backstage, just like mouths open, like, yo, this is like the most mind-blowing-ish of all time. And it was so fascinating. And then it was gone, you know, which we love because like that's jazz.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, I think that would be dope to kind of show that side of yourself too.
Yeah.
We probably showed like 2,000 people in Japan. With like,
that's true.
Yeah, to me, I've never seen you do that outside of your live show, but this was not even with the project in mind. You were just like,
yeah, you
were making beats, bro. Like nothing. I mean, it was like, it was deep. It was like some like John Coltrane, just like, we were just like, yo, is this happening right now?
And I remember I remember being so disappointed in myself that whole tour, because I was on the other side of it looking at you guys like, this is what a finished project your tour looks like. I'm up here just doing bullshit. Like, I don't know what I'm doing. And it's just, you know, it's weird. I don't know why we're always never satisfied with what we're doing.
That's the artist's mind, man.
But yeah, I remember you guys giving me a lot of encouragement that what I was doing was dope at the time. And I was like, you know what? I guess this is what I do. I guess this is, I shouldn't shy away from this. Cause I'd really been doing shows for years where I'm just improvising, making beats from scratch. And that I think I was getting frustrated in myself that I wasn't developing into something finished. But yeah, I mean, that was my vibe for years. Just hopping on stage without a real plan.
Well, hey, I'm putting that in your ear, man. You know, dude, this is awesome. I mean, thank you for reminiscing. This is on my own label now. Let me just talk about that for a second.
Congratulations.
Ryan, gave me 4 photos from back in the day. And it's crazy. I feel like these are like my 4 like personalities sort of like what I'm trying to do. Like the jazz, the little dapper, the like weird b-boy thing. But yeah, I got to send you a copy, man. It's one of my proudest things, actually, you know.
And yeah, the packaging is beautiful. And the album's great. It's still like definitely one of your best pieces of work. And it definitely encapsulated a moment in time that we were talking about. It feels like it really was you being 100% you in this time where it's like a lot of stars aligned to make the project also feel part of that moment. So congratulations on just 10 years and still got classics.
Look younger somehow. And your hair, now my hair is longer than yours, but it was.
That was my trick. I had a bigger beard and longer hair when I was younger. So now I'm trying to like fight the time by going opposite.
Man, well, dude, best of luck on the new project. You know, I can't wait. And yeah, tell everybody where they can find you on socials if they're not following already.
It's easy to find me because it's just my name. It's Taylor McFerrin on all the social platforms. There's no special secret code name. So just look out for me. And yeah, I'll be announcing my next project very soon.
Awesome. Thank you so much, brother.
Yeah, thank you.
One love.
All right, peace.